So as we continue on with these Circuits 1 tutorials, I want to jump into op amps. And we're actually going to do quite a few tutorials about operational amplifiers or op amps. And so that's why I have all of this set up, even though we're not going to be using it in this tutorial specifically. Right now, we're just going to introduce the concept of operational amplifiers and talk about the general way they operate and two of the most important things to remember in their usage that will make things a lot easier. Now, operational amplifiers, or op amps, as I'm going to say because that is quite the mouthful, op amps can be considered scary, but if you really just remember those two basic things and kind of ignore all of the real world complexities at first, then you'll be fine. Once you get more comfortable with them, you can start throwing in some of the more real aspects of op amps, and that's great. You will need to do that at some point, but at the beginning, let's just keep it simple, make sure that you have a good foundational understanding, and then move forward with that. Okay, so first of all, let's look at what an op amp looks like. It's basically a triangle on its side. Whoop. Let's see if I can do that. Two inputs and an output. And that's about it. We usually have one of these marked positive, one of these marked negative, and then we just have output here, which we will call V out. So this can be V in negative, this can be V in positive. And I do want to note that positive, negative, I just pointed at the wrong ones. Positive or negative, it can be either way. It can be on the top or on the bottom. There doesn't seem to be any rhyme or reason. So when you are looking at an op amp, you need to be careful, like where are they going in? Make sure that it's properly labeled and you understand what's going on. Now, an op amp is simply that. It's an amplifier. And the way it works is you just have an equation that drives this output, and that is your V out equals your, basically your amplifier with your V in plus minus V in minus. And to make that simpler, you can just say V plus minus V minus. So that A represents gain, which in an ideal operational amplifier is infinity. So thinking about that, that kind of makes the math harder. So let's just say a rather large number. So as we look at that, our equation is basically the voltage on the outside is the difference between our positive or our input into the positive and our input into the negative times that gain. So right there, you should know that any difference between V in plus, V in minus is going to yield an incredibly large output. And now we will get into that more in more depth later, but right now that's good enough for us to go over the next two big portions of the op amp, the next two big rules for operational amplifiers. Now, the first one is that this operational amplifier will do whatever it can to make these two inputs match. As you look at it, if we were to take this output and then go on over and connect it to the input, you can tell that obviously in this case, your output will drive your V negative over here. And let's look at this equation down here, the way the output works, and see how that makes sense and how these will come into equilibrium. So let's just say that immediately you put 0 volts to V negative, 5 volts to V positive. And so you look at this equation and you have, okay, A, which let's say arbitrarily is 1,000, even though it's going to be much, much greater than that, even in real life, even though it's not going to be infinity. And then you have 5 volts minus 0. And so V out is going to be 1,000 times 5. So your op amp is going to be trying to drive V out to 5,000 volts. And the thing is on its way from 0 to 5,000 volts, because obviously it's not going to be instantaneous, it's going to pass 5 volts. And at that point, 5 minus 5 is 0 times 1,000 or whatever is suddenly 0. So it stops driving and it just keeps that. And as it goes a little bit higher, it'll change the output a little bit to correct. Oh, and then it gets too high, it changes it to correct, and it'll just kind of hit that spot that it's supposed to. And so that is the general principle by which the operational amplifier works in a lot of its configurations, is some sort of variation of that. And that is the simplest, but that's kind of the idea, is that this output will do whatever it can to cause these two inputs to match. And that is the first big rule of operational amplifiers, is that this V negative and V positive should always have the same voltage. And that makes the math so much easier. So if this is in a circuit and V positive is connected to ground, in that circuit, you know that V negative is gonna be connected to ground. If you know that V negative is connected to something and you know the voltage at one, you know the voltage at the other one. And it makes the math so much easier. It makes, it really makes things great. So that is one of the things that's really gonna help you when you are solving circuits that deal with operational amplifiers, is that you can always assume that VN negative and the VN positive, these two terminals will always have the exact same voltage. That's principle number one. Now, principle number two is pretty interesting, and that is that there is going to be zero current into these inputs. So there is absolutely no input current into VN minus or VN plus. And so that also really simplifies things, because then you don't have to deal with it as a third node of like, what's the current going in there? You just know it's going to be zero. So if you have something coming in and something going out, you know those two parts of the circuit have to have the same current in them, and it really simplifies things. Even if you're listening to me right now thinking, how does that simplify things? Trust me, it does. If you know that there's no current going to either of these inputs and you know that they're the same voltage, dealing with op amps is going to become so much easier. Okay, so those are the two most important things and the way you can look at this, and it's nice and simple. And if that's all you need, great. That doesn't take into account a lot of real life issues that we're going to discuss in just a moment. But if the next things I talk about confuse you and you're like, wait, how does that? Then don't even worry about them right now. Again, later you need to. Right now, don't even worry about them. But I'm going to go over them just so you have an idea of the things to expect. Now, one of the things with a real life operational amplifier is you usually have inputs, well, basically your power right here. And this will be some power source, another V plus and V minus right there. And that, especially with old school amplifiers, you would get upwards of 15 volts and negative 15 volts. And I think they even got higher than that. But you know, in today's world where everything's 0 to 5 volts or 0 to 3.3 volts, you get a lot of operational amplifiers that can work on a much lower voltage input than that. But not only is it you get out what you put in, but there's another issue. So first, what I mean by you get out what you put in, if you have a voltage input of on your power side of 0 to 5 volts, and then you have voltages coming in that's trying to get your voltage output to be 7 volts or -3 volts, your operational amplifier can't do that. So its outputs can only be, or its outputs are constrained by the power inputs. So if you do +15, -15, then it can output something in that 30 volt range, unless it can't. Now, if the output can go all the way up to 15 and all the way down to -15 in this case, it's what's called a rail-to-rail amplifier. And that means it can go all the way to the voltage rails. Now, it's more common now to have those rail-to-rail amplifiers, but sometimes you still don't have those. And what happens is you have a little bit of headspace in there that you're losing some voltage on the inside of the amplifier because of voltage drops over PN junctions and stuff like that. And so if you do not have a rail-to-rail amplifier, you need to know, is it taking off 2 volts on each side? So this 15 and -15 actually has an output that can only go from +13 to -13? Don't know. That's something you're going to need to look into. So rail-to-rail power supply, rail-to-rail is much more necessary when you're only going from 0 to 5 volts, but when you have a pretty wide swing like this, then it's more common to see where it's not a rail-to-rail amplifier. And the reason you wouldn't have rail-to-rail amplifiers is because you're always gonna have a trade-off somewhere in some performance. And so that's where it just depends on your application and what you need. But now you're familiar with the term, and let's move on. The next thing to think about when you're looking at a real operational amplifier is, I said that these voltages are always the exact same. Of course, in real life, they're not going to be the exact same. There's going to be some little minute difference, and that's called the offset voltage. Now, the offset voltage is usually a very, very small number, and again, normally you can ignore it, but depending on the precision required, that might be something you need to take into account. However, again, if you're first getting into this and you are doing your basic circuit analysis with an operational amplifier, don't worry about that. Make the assumption that V minus and V plus are the exact same, or else it's gonna get much, much more complicated. But again, in real life, you do need to worry about that. And another thing to worry about with those is in real life, even though we say that there's no current into those inputs, there is a small current. That current is actually called the input bias current. And again, it's going to be incredibly small, and most of the time you're going to be able to ignore it. But again, depending on your application, you may need to consider that, and it may be something that your teacher or your professor says, oh yes, calculate this assuming that there's a difference in the bias current. And if that's the case, I'm sorry, because that does make things a lot more complicated. As I mentioned earlier, the output, as it's driving things, it's not instantaneous. It can't go from zero to infinity instantaneously or zero to anything instantaneously. But we assume that it can when we're doing these calculations. Now, the reality is you can calculate how quickly the voltage will rise or drop, and that's called the slew rate. And so, as I was mentioning, as it's trying to make it go from zero to five, it kind of goes up and it passes through five, and then it's like, oh, hey, it matches and goes like that. And that's because it is moving and it has that slew rate. If it were instantaneous, it'd just jump up and kind of jump down and kind of do this weird bouncing thing, which fortunately it doesn't do. But that slew rate is the inability of the output to produce an infinite amount of current, thereby instantaneously changing the voltage. Did that make sense? So the slew rate is the fact that your output has to change voltage in a non-instantaneous way. So when we're going over these circuits, particularly with the voltage follower, I set up an example, you'll see that that output, it's trying to go from 0 to 5 volts, it goes kind of like this and does a little bit of a bouncing and stuff as it settles in, because it can't just 0, 5 instantaneously. So that's the slew rate, and sometimes that's your friend, most of the time it's not. All right, and that leaves us with one final thing that's related to the slew rate, and that is bandwidth. So as I've been talking about this, I've been envisioning, and you probably have been as well, DC circuits. But this also works with AC circuits. And so when you're doing an AC circuit, that's where you're going to see more of that slew rate. And you're also going to have problems with the bandwidth, which once you get up to a certain frequency, basically your operational amplifier, your op amp, is not going to be able to keep up. It's not going to be able to recreate or create the signal quickly enough to have any sort of integrity. You get to this point where it just doesn't work anymore and you're outside of the bandwidth of the op amp. And that is a case of if you're having something that's changing very, very quickly and the slew rate just simply can't keep up, you're not going to be reproducing the signal accurately. And so that's where you say, you know, forget it, this operational amplifier isn't going to work, let's find another op amp, or we need to find a completely different solution altogether. Okay, and that is it. We are going to go into a lot of the most common configurations, because these are all over the place in circuits, and once you get that foundational understanding, they are not only easy, but they are so incredibly helpful. So again, those first two rules are, the first one is that these two inputs have a matching voltage, always. Just remember that when you're doing anything and you're looking at a circuit like, how am I supposed to do this? Remember that if you know, if one's tied to ground or if one's tied to 5 volts or whatever, you know what the other voltage is immediately. And then the second thing is there is no current into those inputs. So any current that is flowing past has to keep on flowing past. So in the feedback loop, you're going to have the same current there as you do on the input. Those are the two things. They're very, very important. Other than that, op amps are pretty straightforward. They do get more complicated with the realistic aspects thrown in, but still, that's nothing to worry about right now. And it's really not that bad once you have a good grasp of how they work. Okay, I'm really excited to do the next couple of op amp videos. They are going to be a lot of fun because they are so incredibly powerful, and I'm really glad for the equipment I have here that can show the way it actually works. So I'm very excited. I hope you'll join us with those videos. I hope you enjoyed this video and it has helped you understand operational amplifiers a little bit more. I'm realizing right now, right at the very end, that I have not slowed my speech down, and I apologize for that. If this was too fast, please slow it down in the YouTube settings. Thanks. If you liked it, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, all that good jazz. We'll catch you in the next one.